Welcome to Norse Code, the number one podcast for your Minnesota Vikings. I am your host, Dusty O'Connell, and I am here with in-house analyst, blogger, and Vikings football expert, Arif Hassan. How you doing, Arif?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing better than Orlando Scandrick.
Jesus. No, I think a lot of us are doing better than Orlando Scandrick, as well as Jordy Nelson.
But even he's doing better. And that's the thing, is that, like, you know, just tearing your ACL in the preseason is old and busted. Literally everyone does that, from Jordy Nelson to Phil Loadholt. And Orlando Scandrick was like, nah, you know, I'm the new hotness. I'm going to tear both my ACL and MCL in one play in the preseason and be out.
Well, Phil Loadholt tore his Achilles.
Or Achilles. Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. Wow.
Which is the same tendon that trash Washington player Junior Gallette tore.
At any rate, one ligament or tendon is no longer enough. The bar has been raised to two. So no, I am fully ambulatory, and so I'm doing great.
That's good news.
It is good news. I have good news for our listeners as well. We have an actual episode planned for you this week, not a phone in or just a quick jog around the stadium or an episode peppered with ironic references to DraftKings.com. a full-on precap and recap for you, along with updates about the Norse Code Fantasy Football League, some fun promotional news from both the NFL and from us. And, of course, the latest about your Minnesota Vikings. Playoff contenders, I still insist.
I mean, you're technically not wrong if you say every team is a playoff contender, so I don't think...
I didn't say every team was a playoff contender. I said the Vikings were.
But I'm just saying that you can't be wrong because also every other team is a playoff contender. I'm not saying you said every team was. I'm saying every team is.
I am totally taking that out of context. The part where you said I can't be wrong. I'm gonna cut that out, and like I'm gonna make that my ringtone, like my text tone.
But it's in a pretty exasperated voice, so.
Not really, compared to some of your other like more exasperated voices. Like you can get pretty exasperated. I feel like I've plumbed the depths of your frustration on this show pretty well. and that was not it. Trust me.
Yeah, well, I'm looking forward to future depth plumbing of my exasperation.
Well, episode 79 has just started. we've got a whole 90 minutes to kill here. You put out a 53-man roster prediction on the Daily Norseman. Indeed. That is nearly identical to Andy Carlson's on Vikings territory. And you received some minor Twitter accolades. Paul Allen had some kind things to say about your work.
You make it seem like I copied Andy's. His did come out before mine was published, but mine was like, you know.
Yours was done first.
It was done first.
I know how you operate. You know how you operate. I didn't mean to make it seem like you copied Andy's. I always knew that even though his has an earlier timestamp on it, that you were probably like 99% done with it before he was. So,
well, I don't know whose was done first. Just mine was done before his was published.
Oh, that's all I'm saying. Well, at any rate, it's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, wait, it's a 53-man roster prediction. It's like, there's not a lot of ways to screw that up. I mean, there's a ton of ways, but there's not a lot of ways that people will screw it up.
Well, then we have the bonus of having, I guess, a 54-man roster, what with PUP and et cetera stuff. So you got a little bit of room for fungibility. And there's the Babatunde 10-man Ayegbusi exemption.
Yeah, no, the roster this year was, you know, quote-unquote, easier to construct than it was other years because there's just so much. There's actually a lot of wiggle room. I could choose to have a fullback or not, and choosing not to have a fullback made things super easy. I could choose to have a third quarterback or not, and choosing not to have a third quarterback made things super easy. And then Jabari Price, I didn't have to worry about him. So I just sort of pseudo-added him to the team. And so getting rid of him, but not really, made that super easy. And usually people struggle with 53, 54, 55. And when you get rid of three positions without having to think about them, now I didn't. And I cut down to 52. Then the biggest issue was actually getting back to 53, because I was like, well, I could add Taylor Heinicke, or I could add one of the two defensive backs that Mike Zimmer is known to like, Josh Thomas or DeMarcus Van Dyke. And so I created a tough to cut list as I was cutting, so I could talk about them in the article. And doing that made it super easy to narrow down the people I might have wanted to add back in.
But dude, we're going with a third quarterback, right? Like both you and Andy only had two quarterbacks in the depth chart, and I mean, yeah, we saw that, you know, Sean Hill looks like a solid backup quarterback, and obviously Teddy's the man. But dude, this is the Vikings. Like, does anyone remember last season?
Yeah, and why? Anyone who listens to this podcast is also well aware of how often the Vikings go to their third quarterback. But I will say this thing, which is, while it is more likely than not that they'll have a third quarterback, A, I needed to save myself a headache, and B, you can have your third quarterback on the practice squad, and all that means is that you can't call upon them in a game. But if you go to your third quarterback in a game, they haven't had any reps with the offense ever anyway. So why not make it fun and make Jerick McKinnon the third quarterback? That was my thinking. I was like, well, you could make... And I know Jerick McKinnon isn't the emergency quarterback. I think it's like Jarius Wright or... Yeah, it's probably not Cordarrelle Patterson anymore, let's be honest. But at one point, it was potentially Cordarrelle Patterson.
Wow.
And and also, like, Jarius Wright is a candidate for that. Don't really know why or what the thought process behind that is. But sure. And but I like the idea of it being Jerick McKinnon, because he ran an option offense, not because he's technically paid quarterback, because that's clearly not important, but, you know, because he ran an option offense, and it'd just be fun to see a Georgia Tech, Georgia Southern style offense. I don't know if Georgia Southern does it anymore with their new head coach, but, an option style offense with the Vikings. Obviously, you can't install it mid-game, but I can dream.
It's true, and chances are, if the imaginary quarterback has to step in halfway through the game, then, you know, they'll need him later. So maybe if Taylor Heinicke isn't available off the practice squad, maybe Jerick will be our. You know what? Let's not even entertain the thought. This is dangerous territory for a jinx-prone team.
It's just most teams have two quarterbacks, and it makes a lot of sense because that roster spot's really valuable. I guess you have to have the third quarterback on your roster, even if it doesn't have to be on their game day roster to get the
quarterback
exemption. It's really, the roster rules for third quarterbacks are really weird, and they create incentives to actually have a third quarterback because, you know, you can only have a game day roster of 45 players, but that's dumb. I don't know why that is, but you can only have a game day roster of 45 players, and then 8 people are declared inactive. But one of those inactive people, if they're a quarterback, can be declared the emergency quarterback, and if both your quarterbacks can go down, this person can now go into the game as the third quarterback, even though they weren't active. And so there's an additional incentive to have a third quarterback on the roster. But despite that, people are still only rolling with two quarterbacks because you don't give your third quarterback reps anyway. So my thought process was, you're not going to give them reps. This would be really fun if it got screwed up anyway, so let's do it.
So it doesn't matter. Yeah, that's fair. The more interesting part to me was, and you wrote a little bit about this on Daily Norseman, this is going to be the first season, if your roster prediction is correct, that the Vikings roll without a fullback.
It's the first season that the Vikings will, and it's the first season that Norv Turner will. North Turner's always had a fullback. I remember last year when people were talking about how they might not have a fullback, I was like, there's no way that's true. North Turner's always had a fullback. There are a lot of years where he's had two fullbacks. He had two fullbacks in Washington. He had two fullbacks in Dallas. He had two fullbacks in San Diego. He's had two fullbacks a lot, and he's had a lot of really good fullbacks. He knows how to utilize a fullback in an offense, but they're so bad this year. Like, I'm kind of pissed still that the Vikings didn't retain Jerome Felton, because it would have been super cheap to retain him, and Zach Line isn't good at fullback. Maybe he will be by the end of the year, and I'm wrong, but like he's had a lot of years to learn how to play blocking fullback instead of running fullback, and he's still not good at it. So I'm kind of pissed. And the only insurance the Vikings got was a position convert from Boise State, Blake Reynaud, who played linebacker at Boise State, so now he has to learn how to play fullback. And I know that the Vikings have done this before. Ryan D'Imperio, I think he's from Iowa or Iowa State. Either way, the Hawkeye listeners and the Cyclone listeners will be angry that I don't know. But he got converted to fullback, but he spent a year on the practice squad in order for that to happen. We don't have a fullback, which is like weird to complain about. But they've been like pretty important for the Vikings, except for Nafahu Tahi, who is forever a villain.
Well, historically, but I mean, we're looking at a team that is likely to play more out of the shotgun. In fact, they're even working on, you know, getting Adrian Peterson into playing more out of the shotgun rather than, you know, the 7-yard drop. But I mean, if Zach Line is the best you can do at fullback, like is, I guess if the question is Zach Line better than nothing, then maybe the answer really is no. I mean, we've never really been that high on him on the show.
Yeah, no, the show, well, I mean, we were when the Vikings picked him up as an undrafted free agent because I thought he was really cool. But I did say, hey, he has to learn, you know, how to play NFL fullback instead of, I shouldn't say NFL fullback, Vikings fullback instead of SMU fullback, because at SMU he ran the ball, he had to avoid contact, he had to, you know, go through holes and stuff like that. In the NFL, he can't do that. He has to identify blockers and pick them up, and he hasn't shown an ability to. So,
well, it sounds like scheme-wise, the Vikings are okay with going away from one that includes a fullback towards one that tries to, I guess, spread out defenses more and introduce some dynamic dynamism.
Yeah, possibly, yeah. The Vikings had played a, well, I don't know if it's historically low, but it's probably a historically low number of snaps at the fullback position. Only 175 out of 1,000 snaps they took last year included Jerome Felton on the field. And that's not even at the fullback position. That's on the field at all. So, you know, that's
for those of you who are not math nerds, that is 1.75%.
Well, actually, it's a little bit more complicated. It's actually 1,100 snaps. But I rounded down by 100 whole snaps, even though that significantly affects the math for listeners.
Exactly. With a 1% error rate, you son of a bitch. Now even I can't do the math.
It's a 10% error rate, and you definitely can't do the math.
That was the joke. But thank you.
But then I noticed, so I was talking to Krauserific, who is a listener to the show and comments my articles, and he's a very good commenter, about the Vikings not having a fullback. And I was like, well, there's a lot of really successful goal line teams that don't have a fullback. And then, so I said that. I wrote out the comment. I didn't press publish. And then I researched whether or not my proposition was true. And it was kind of true, but it actually kind of cemented how important fullbacks are to me. I feel like I'm kind of wrong now. Because he brought up the point, like, hey, well, what about goal line packages? Once you get there, it's kind of important that you score. I'm like, well, it's the goal line. You could just score. It's, you know, whatever. But then I looked it up, and in a lot of the most successful goal line teams basically have a fullback. The only teams that don't have a fullback that are really successful at the goal line are Philadelphia, and that's, like, different. You have to basically have their offensive scheme. And Cincinnati, who have someone play the fullback position, but it's a nose tackle, D'Amato Pecco, and St. Louis, who have a tight end just play fullback for them. So that's what everyone else who's successful at the goal line, Tampa Bay, Dallas, St. Louis, Pittsburgh, or not St. Louis, Tampa Bay, Dallas, Pittsburgh, San Diego, Kansas City, they all have a fullback, and they're all very successful at the goal line. And I don't know if there really is a positive correlation. There's certainly not a sample size to say with any confidence that the positive correlation means anything. The Vikings played a fullback on 2/3 of their snaps at the goal line, which I'm defining as from the 3 and closer. And they were more successful on those plays that they had a fullback than the ones they did not have a fullback. I wouldn't be surprised if I was wrong, because it is actually useful to have a flex. You just shouldn't pay them very much because they're only there for a couple of snaps, and they add some value, but not a ton. But, you know, who knows? So maybe the Vikings have a third quarterback, because they said third quarterbacks are great in the history of the Vikings. You know, third quarterbacks. And maybe they have a fullback, in which case my 53-man roster prediction gets really tough.
And at the end of the day, it really doesn't matter that much. I just thought it was neat that you got a little bit of Twitter love for...
from the legendary Paul Allen. That was pretty cool.
PA on the mic. Because when he rocks a mic right.
Vote PA.
Hashtag vote PA. Either him or Larry Lessig. I would accept either. Let's see here. A little bit of promotional news this week. Well, first of all, one note about Norse Code. As I was going through and listening to last week's episode in order to set up jokes for this episode, you guys know that we're not actually sponsored by DraftKings.com. Right? And not you guys as in like you and James, but like you all as in the listeners who are ostensibly still listening to this show. We are actually very proud of the fact that because of you all, we don't have to run ads for anyone. And DraftKings ads are, you know, they're fine for television because, you know, that's money in the bank for whatever TV network. But DraftKings ads, FanDuel ads, Audible ads, poison for podcasts because they're all affiliate marketing. Nobody gets any money at all until people start signing up for the service with the offer code, blah, 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 et cetera, et cetera. We, frankly, are glad for the opportunity to not have to waste 3 minutes talking about them and instead use that 3 minutes to talk about us.
Yes, we're very much into talking about us. But I thought we made it somewhat clear, given how sarcastic we were about DraftKings.com, where you can play daily fantasy at any time without having to worry about your roster. We thought that we were being very clear that we weren't sponsored by DraftKings.com, where there are no headaches about whether or not your player's injured.
Well, the... that definitely made our position much clearer. Thank you, Arif.
I'm here to serve. Much like
I just wanted to, much like DraftKings.com, DraftKings.com. No, stop. Right. Wow. I just wanted to draw a bright line between our relationship with advertisers and, say, Russell Wilson's.
Oh, my God. My eyes bled when I saw the news. Then I needed some recovery water.
did you cry tears of healing afterward? Were they made mostly of recovery water?
Well, okay, so here's the thing about recovery water. Obviously, it doesn't heal concussions, and obviously the nanobubble stuff is bullshit. I mean, kind of. I'll explain a little bit about that.
So does carbonated water have nanobubbles?
Every water has nanobubbles. Let's be clear about this.
Just so y'all know, nano just means, like, tiny.
Right, well, in this case, it means, you know, bubbles that are so small you can't see them with the naked eye. There's a scientific study on nanobubbles. They're a thing. And you can't see them with the naked eye, which, whatever, they're obviously just small bubbles. So every water has nanobubbles in it. I would not be surprised if their water had more nanobubbles in it because you can induce nanobubble creation in really high-pressure environments, and they stay stable afterwards.
What, just by, like, shooting pressurized water into, like, a very finely pitted glass vessel?
Exactly. Actually, you're not even a scientist, and you know that. You're not even anything remotely approaching a scientist.
I'm a mixologist.
I knew you were going to say that, you little shithead.
See, this is the kind of Arif exasperation I was talking about.
Yeah, well, next we're going to talk about coffee, and I'm just going to hang up and you can finish the show.
I think we've already exhaustively covered that.
Exhaustively. I'm sure you could spout on for another hour. Anyway.
Look, man, is that I changed Sean Fahey's life with the introduction of cold brew.
Did he say that?
Yes.
Oh, well, we hear it in Norse Code.
Excuse me, no, not Sean Fahey, Oscar Hazel.
Okay, because actually it's John Fahey, not Sean.
It's written like it's Sean.
Wait, unless we're talking about different listeners, because I know there's a John Fahey who listens to the podcast.
No, the guy that writes for Football Outsiders.
Oh. Cian.
Whatever, they're all pronounced Sean.
I think it's actually Kian, but it's an Irish name, it doesn't matter.
Right now, yeah. At any rate, nanobubbles.
Okay, yes.
Formed on the inside surface of a bottle when pressurized water is shot into it.
Right.
Russell Wilson likes them.
Yeah, okay, so he thinks the nanobubbles and maybe some other stuff in the recovery water helped with his concussion. No evidence to say that at all. In fact, his agent went out of his way at the interview about, you know, him promoting, you know, recovery water to say, to be clear, there is no medical proof for this. And then Russell Wilson basically shook him off and he's like, yeah, but it's true, so we don't have to worry about that. But the thing is, the recovery water itself, it's better for you in some contexts than water, in the same way that sugarless Gatorade is better for you in some contexts than water. It's better than water at preventing hangovers if you have them after you have a night of drinking, for example. Both recovery water and Gatorade will do that. In fact, I bet recovery water does it better because sugar dehydrates you, and you want to avoid that. Because it has electrolytes, you know, what plants crave.
I like Brondo.
Exactly. But yeah, so like it has like salts in it and stuff like that. Not just table salt, but other kinds of salt.
But if you're genuinely dehydrated, adding sugar to a salted or electrolyted solution makes the salty, like basic electrolytes, more bioavailable. Yeah.
It helps the medicine go down, basically.
Yes.
Right. Yes. So yeah, so it is theoretically better water. The sugar isn't there, so it's not as bioavailable as Gatorade, which is one of the reasons that Gatorade does help more than regular water. But it also is it's just sugarless. That's all it is, sugarless Gatorade. But the nanobubbles, they're interesting because there's a lot of potential scientific applications for it. At which point, someone on my timeline confused the research into nanobubbles with, if we just put nanobubbles in shit, it's better. No. The scientific research about nanobubbles is that it could be really interesting as a drug carrier. Because, you know, it penetrates through cell walls better because it's a tiny bubble. So that makes a lot of sense. And I tried to explain to this person.
So you would need like nano drugs to put into the nanobubbles.
Right, yeah, that's a very clear.
Directly injected in, or not injected, but could directly pass through into cells and bypass a lot of the metabolic processes that are designed to keep things out of cells.
Yeah, no, definitely a big part of that is that you need the nano drugs in them. Like that's like a big part of that. This person couldn't understand that. And I was like, water is a very good drug carrier too. So, like, it's not different. It's just, it just carries things. It's not by itself good because, again, viruses are a really good drug carrier. Some retroviruses can be really interesting in the way they could help in terms of medical applications. That does not mean all viruses are just good to inject in you. In the same way, nanobubbles are not just good because you can do a good thing with them. But this person was like, well, that's what they want you to think. And I was like, that what?
Who are they?
Well, they didn't say.
Is it big nanobubble?
Big. It's a word joke. Anyway, they didn't say
yes,
they.
It was.
But he's like, that's what some people think, and I was like, that's what everyone who knows things about things thinks because that's how things work. But I didn't go off, and he kept on tweeting, and I was like, you just dig your own hole defending nanobubbles in a timeline full of nanobubble skeptics.
Now, what did we learn?
Don't read the comments.
Don't feed the trolls.
Well, he was a troll. He thought he was, you know, right.
I am not convinced that there is any kind of, like, bright line between trolls who troll out of idiocy and trolls who troll out of, like, thinking they're smarter than you.
Well, but he was trying to be... there's no way I can explain this without... It's sounding like he's a troll because trolls...
Because that's what he was doing.
No,
he didn't.
Trolls
he was,
engage he was, in exaggerated versions of the behavior that I'm describing, which is that he was trying to literally actually be a voice of reason on all the nanobubble hate when he was talking about all the scientific research that has been done on and with nanobubbles. But I'm not saying...
Whether he believes it or not, the result is the same. And
well, but he wasn't, like insisting himself upon people. He wasn't, like, tweeting at... He wasn't adding people. He wasn't getting into people's mentions. So that's significantly less trolling.
I mean, I guess you could delineate it along how much attention they were looking for, but maybe he's just bad at that too.
He's just bad at so he's trolling, but he's
clearly
bad at,
he was befuddled by the nanobubble situation. Oh my! Like,
he wasn't a troll. He's kind of dumb.
Lots of trolls are like that.
But that doesn't make you a troll.
It's like the film The Sixth Sense. I see trolls trolling everywhere. They don't even know they're trolls.
And I think that just means you're paranoid.
Well, that may be true. My favorite comment about Russell Wilson's recovery water was from Ethan Hammerman, a regular guest and a friend of the show. Look forward to having him on during Patriots Week.
Do we have Patriots Week this year?
I hope so. I would love to have Ethan on the show.
Well, we'll do it during the playoffs because that's basically Patriots Week.
Whatever. He claims that recovery water is made from the distilled tears of Noshan Moreno.
I saw that. That was good.
Which made me laugh and clap my hands just a little bit.
Okay, so we're so all...
Here's my thing, though, about the recovery water situation. Like, water itself is pretty freaking good.
Yeah, you know, water definitely contributes to recovery.
Wars have been fought all over Africa over a lack of access to water. Entire political careers have been built and then destroyed. Entire presidential campaigns have fallen apart on just what to do with the Colorado River, which only runs through a few states here in America. It's really, really, like, why does water need other words in front of it, like recovery or smart, in order to sell it?
I can't believe... there was a time in my life when I bought smart water.
So if you... If you, like, take a bottle of smart water into a restaurant and then forget it when you leave, is that ironic?
No. The water's smart, not you.
But you drank it. Shouldn't that make you smart?
No, no, no. And eating smart things doesn't make you smart.
So I should stop eating dolphins then?
Yeah. That. Yep. Whatever reason you need to stop eating dolphins, that's the correct reason.
But they're delicious.
That's awful. Thanks for that news.
They're so smart.
Yeah.
I'm incorporating their awesome power into myself. The whole like thing reminds me of a Simpsons quote from one of the forgettable seasons, you know, where one of the seasons where everyone on Reddit will just insist that The Simpsons is terrible now. it doesn't even matter what the number is. It's beyond 12, whatever. Right. But Marge goes up to a kiosk at the grocery store that's all about the flavored waters, not smart water. They come in like different colors. There was a Facebook branded one. Whatever. It was, I think the name on the show for it was Science Water. And Marge tried like three or four different samples that were supposed to have different, you know, beneficial effects on her body or whatever. And Wait. We mentioned Ethan Hammerman. We mentioned the Patriots. I get to have a parting shot on my stupid water kick. Yes. Tom Brady is apparently a fan of blue solar water. Hat tip to in-house analyst Arif Hassan for revealing this to the world on Twitter. Excuse me.
You sound like you have a case of the gas, which blue solar water can help you with, among many other indefinable things.
I am
okay. So
making the most exasperated face right now. You can't hear it, but it's happening.
Okay, wait. So this is why blue solar water is awesome, though. Because it's the worst scam of all the homeopathy scams I've ever seen.
Well, hold on. Blue solar water is water that has been poured into a blue glass bottle and left to sit in the sun for a while. That's all it is.
Distilled water. It has to be pure when it goes in, obviously.
Oh.
But you
don't give it to your babies.
But you can distill water.
Or do.
Well, yeah, whatever, man. Just make sure your baby gets minerals after that. The stuff that you got rid of in the water, just put it in your breast milk or something. I don't know. But just put it in your breast milk. Yeah, it's
pretty. So if your baby is drinking blue solar water, mom should not. Or vice versa.
I don't think it'll work. Like, I think the people who drink blue soda water give it to everybody in the family, including themselves. So I think basically you just have to eat some rocks. It's fine. But
that's sad because it is a horrible homeopathy scam, and it's not even like a good one. It's
right,
just
because
like,
you can't make
it's like clumsy.
You don't make any money off of it. The ones making money off it are just selling blue glass bottles. And even in the question and answer section of some of these websites, they're like, "So what makes these bottles special?" It's like, "Well, they're blue." Like that's it. And so you just need some blue. Which, by the way, any starting brewing kit, the default like bottle that they give you to brew beer in is just a clear blue glass bottle. And so you just put some distilled water in it, sit in the sun for 1 to 12 hours. I assume 13 isn't bad either. And now it's solarized, and it activates or interacts with the fifth chakra, which is called
solarized.
The throat chakra. I don't know if that's the word they use. I'm just, it's,
okay.
It's you
okay.
know.
I was gonna, if that was, I would have had a moment.
Yeah, but the fifth chakra, that didn't give you a moment?
I'm look, man, I lived in Boulder for like 6 years. I can let a lot of hippie stuff just pass over me like water. I did learn to be like water, not like blue solar water, thankfully.
Yeah, because you have key amounts of trace elements in you. So.
Good.
Yes.
I'm glad. They're probably very rare and hard to find. Water. Unlike water and blue bottles.
Water conducts and attunes to the vibrational frequency or energy of crystals, colors, and words. Solar elixirs, or sun-charged water, is an old science that has been rediscovered today as one of the many treatment techniques of color therapy, or color healing. Blue is the color of the fifth chakra, or throat chakra, Vishuddha. The throat chakra is vital, as it is the route through which the energy from the higher energy centers, the crown and brow chakras, can move through to the lower energy centers, root, sacral, solar plexus, and heart, and vice versa. I think it's vice versa, but that's not what the text says. This energy center.
Well, the text also says an old science.
Well,
so
well,
your mileage may vary.
Well, but I mean, it's not like old science doesn't exist. I mean, that's a thing that exists. Science that existed before the modern era. Yeah, it's just unreliable.
If only there was some sort of method you could use to test it.
Well, yeah, obviously the chakra method. Physical aspect, endocrine system, respiratory system. So it affects those. It infects the inner aspect, your creative expression, your self-expression, your personal willpower. It also affects your communication, both speaking and listening. That'd be good for us here on Norse Code. It impacts your mental action, in particular fluent thought, which is not an adjective I've seen describe thought. Emotional action. Independence is the emotion, I guess. That's not really an emotion, but that's what they list. And then spiritual action, security. It is relaxing, it is calming, it's soothing, and it's key to regeneration. So it's a lot like recovery water with less stuff in it, which makes it worse than recovery water. But you can't make any money scamming people with it, so it's better than recovery water.
Well, it depends on whether or not you're the one selling the blue bottles.
Yeah, right, but like, blue bottles are pretty cheap. Like,
well,
it's one of the easiest colors to produce.
Unless they are specially designed to solarize water.
Yeah, the websites don't even say that. Like, it's a really poorly run scam.
Look, man, I'm just going to buy a bottle of Sky Vodka and leave it in the sun for a while.
I assume we have to get all the alcohol out. That's a toxin.
Well, but, like, vodka is 60% water.
Yeah, it's also...
It should be at least 60% as good, right? Like, I should notice some benefits along with being drunk, right?
Well, I don't know what their theory is. I assume it makes it better. Like, it can't make it worse, right?
But that's my feeling. I mean, it might upset my throat chakra some. I know it kind of burns going down, but...
No, but well, but that's the alcohol. I mean, if you're committed to drinking the vodka either way, then yeah, just put it in the sun and that
maybe,
probably
maybe
makes
that's
it better.
Maybe that's the secret to vodka that won't burn.
No, that's definitely not, no.
It's not that. But Tom Brady likes it. I read,
Dude, that New York Times article is a trip. He eats like...
Is that the one where he talks, where the author talks about how Tom Brady likes to call everybody babe, regardless of gender?
Yeah, exactly. Which makes it even funnier... when there's that commercial about him having an awful Boston accent and he goes to California and people can't understand him even though he's just talking. He's very clearly a California dude. I mean, there's no question about that. And the fact that he calls everyone babe regardless of gender is definitely very good evidence of that.
I wouldn't even call my significant other babe. Babe is the name of a pig in a movie.
And that's all it is.
And that's all it is to me.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't call people babe, so that's...
Well, you're not Tom Brady.
Well, that's, you know, I was going to say that's totally fine, but that's not. I would rather call everybody babe and be Tom Brady than... This is sad. Can we move on?
Yeah, well, just between us, I personally am very glad that you are not Tom Brady, Arif. Well, now let's get on to some Vikings news.
I would still do the podcast.
No, you wouldn't.
No, but I would say I would.
Chris Carter made some headlines this week. He could have made headlines, what is it, 2 years ago when he was addressing the NFL, like, rookie meetup or whatever.
It was actually the 2014 rookie symposium, but everyone keeps on saying 2 years ago, so maybe it was mislabeled, but whatever.
Okay. So like a year ago. Well, no,
because Teddy Bridgewater was called up on stage, so it was before the 2014 season, because it was Teddy Bridgewater that was called up on stage. So it wasn't two years ago, it was one.
Okay. So last year, Chris Carter gave what I believe to be some excellent advice to incoming rookies. The NFL, when reached for comment, did not disavow that Chris Carter had said these things, but merely said that they had requested that this statement remained off the record.
Well, so they can't say he didn't say this. They posted the video on their website.
Well, I guess good job keeping it off the record, then.
Well, right. I mean, that's classic NFL. The right hand doesn't know what the left is doing. But yeah, they asked that this be kept off the record when Robert Klemko attended the rookie symposium and reported on it. And then the NFL posted a bunch of videos from the rookie symposium that no one watched, because why would you watch a bunch of players telling rookies not to get in trouble? But then it turns out we should have watched
them. Turns out Chris Carter has better advice than that.
You're right.
Way better.
You gotta have a fall guy.
How did he phrase it? This is not an exact quote. This is only from memory. But I think he used words to the effect that, you know, if you're going to be rolling with a crew of people, at the end of the day, one of them has to know if something goes down, they're going to get arrested.
One of them fools is going to jail. We're going to get them out, but one of those fools has to go to jail.
The point is that it's not you, Mr. NFL rookie. It's one of your boys.
Yeah. And then he pulled Teddy up on the stage and was like, "This is Teddy Bridgewater, Inc." At which point Warren Sapp nodded sagely and then said "Incorporated," as if, you know, maybe people needed to know what Inc. meant in this context, which actually I don't know if that actually elucidated anything. Because either you knew it and didn't know what it stood for, or you knew it and you knew what it stood for. But I think everyone kind of knew what Inc. stood for there.
Warren Sapp knows a big word.
Yeah, so Warren Sapp sagely nodded and said "Incorporated." And then Chris Carter said, you know, your body makes all the money, every dime that you have comes through your body, through Teddy Bridgewater, Inc. And then he didn't say, but he basically implied that, you know, the crew is all, they all live, you know, off of you, which, yeah, that's probably true, I guess. And so one of them has to take the fall for you. Which, you know, Chris Carter is applying a very old corporate lesson, you know, and applying it to people who are corporations.
This isn't even a corporate lesson. This is just like, this is Animal Kingdom 101.
You know, it's Animal Kingdom 101. But it's been repurposed by corporations and now by Chris Carter.
Well, and now, but for some reason, when Chris Carter says it to incoming NFL rookies, suddenly it's inappropriate.
Well, you can't tell people publicly.
But this wasn't public. I mean, it was made public. It was at the rookie symposium. How many times a year do you think this happens at auditoriums full of people that work for Google or Amazon or Facebook or Apple or GM or... Lehman, well, not Lehman Brothers, Goldman Sachs.
Our intern did it. Our intern did all the derivatives trading. I can't really believe so our well intern did all of, he gambled on bad loans. Bad intern. He has been fired.
Well, no, exactly.
It was not like
all of these, could. All of these companies have fall guys, and all of that
Well, that's what I was saying, is that this
part
is
of the lesson. If you, exactly. It's a lesson no matter what industry you work in that it is really, really good to have a patsy.
Right, but like it is immoral, which is why it can't be public that the NFL is endorsing people who give this advice.
It's not immoral if the patsy knows they're doing it.
I'm not making an ethical judgment. I'm saying that publicly it's immoral because, and there's a good reason to think this, Dusty, it is unethical not to take responsibility for your own actions. And second, and this is not really what Chris Carter was doing, but second, it does give kind of a signal that it is okay to do, you know, all of these things that we just told you not to do. And there's psychological research backing this up, that if you say, don't do this, but if you do this, you should, you know, do this if you're doing it. There's psychological research that backs it up that says you're slightly more likely to do it now because now you've got, like, sort of a moral backdoor, psychologically speaking, to be able to do it. So there's a couple of reasons to think that you shouldn't be giving this advice, and certainly you shouldn't let this advice get out to the public. But I ultimately agree with you, Dusty, that if the fall guy, you know, consents to it or whatever, that it is not significantly immoral. But there is something to be said about taking responsibility for your own actions, even if the person who ends up taking responsibility for your action, you know, consents to it. That makes it significantly more moral, obviously. But, you know, that's like a thing. Obviously, that's a thing.
This is going to be a pretty broad digression, and at the risk of getting political, I'm not going to name any names. I'm only going to, you know, identify a thought experiment. But there are times when a leader or an employee or someone in an organization is either because they're so vital to its operation or so charismatic or their function cannot be duplicated by literally anyone else that it is important to have, you know, insurance on them. Now, showing up one day at the door of someone who works in the office and being like, you're the patsy now, you're fired, and enjoy the media shitstorm. Yeah, horribly immoral, horribly unethical. Should never, ever do that because that is a borderline criminal abdication of responsibility.
Literally a criminal abdication of responsibility, but okay.
Well, depending on who we're talking about, borderline.
Oh, fine. Okay, go on. Actually criminal.
You really want me to make this political, don't you? like, I'm really trying hard and you're not helping.
Keep going.
The alternative is for someone who wants to be a part of a winning or otherwise successful organization, whether it be a bank, a football team, a large corporation, even a small company with some really, you know, crazy ideas. Maybe they just want to be on the ground floor of a good thing. And they don't have, you know, the technical chops or the charismatic chops, or they're not handsome enough for whatever reason. Their best purpose in that organization is to be the fall guy. As long as someone volunteers for it, great. Because at the end of the day, I mean, especially in, you know, America, in corporate America, you know, we talk a good game about personal responsibility or whatever, but what we really want, especially in this era of corporations that exist as people, is just someone in the organization to take responsibility, right? Someone in the posse has to go down.
Well, okay, so let me interrupt you in a couple of ways. The first...
That's it. I'm done.
Okay, great. So the first thing is, this is definitely a great football podcast, but it's you're looking at it from a singular moral perspective, and there's a second moral perspective where it makes a lot of sense too, which is that you as a corporation or you as Teddy Bridgewater Incorporated have a moral responsibility to your stakeholders, the people that invest in your company, and that you have a moral responsibility not only to pay them back, but to, you know, keep, you know, the business going because they've invested their time and money and research into you, which is fine. And so as a corporation, you and your ethical responsibility to them is to continue the successful operation of the business, which in many ways necessitates a fall guy. So from the perspective of consent ethics, yes. From the perspective of moral responsibility to stakeholders, yes. But there is something to be said about the morality of punishing the person who did a wrong thing that is independent of those things. And so I think when you have that moral quandary, I think sort of the ethics of those things conflict. The question then becomes, is there an intrinsic moral good that comes from maintaining this, in this case, let's say the CEO of a company, or the ethical responsibility of a company overall, or in the case of a football player. And I think for a football player, there's no intrinsic moral value to them having a clean reputation.
History says no on all counts, and the only people that disagree are hot take artists that demand that the game be played the right way.
What? Okay. Thanks for branding me that way, Dusty. There's another thing here, though, which is that because human psychology is shitty, and because we just need someone to blame, that therefore is morally true. Which is weird, because you're basically saying is, because this is how the public reacts, that this is an ethically good thing, which we just talked about is just not true. We just talked about how that's not really a thing, about how if something is, it therefore is good. Like, we know that's not true. So the fact that people want someone to blame doesn't make it such that it is morally ethical for us to punish someone else for someone doing something wrong. Which is why I brought up the moral conflict between keeping the character clean of an institution that is necessary to have the character kept clean or not. And there's no reason for football players, you know, morality to be kept clean intrinsically, you know, for the public good. Whereas, let's say, for a president, that may be true, possibly. It depends. Probably not, because public accountability is good. But, you know, maybe. And, you know, this question came up, I think, with John Oliver, talked about sweatshops and subcontracting, you know, clothing production, and how by subcontracting you can always say, oop, we didn't know that they engaged in sweatshop practices. That's weird. And you can just keep saying that every single year, and now you don't have any sweatshops. And that's awful.
Deeply disingenuous. And I applaud Chris Carter for kind of fighting against that mentality. Like, so if you're in the textile industry, then you know that the entire, you know, t-shirt making industry basically uproots itself and moves to a country where it can exploit workers for the least amount of money. It used to be Bangladesh. Now it's kind of Brazil and Bangladesh. And as soon as they find a place in Africa where they can move their machines and have them work and grease the local government palms, it'll be fine. And they'll just go there instead. And, you know, for these, you know, global companies to subcontract this stuff out and be like, oh, well, we didn't know. Like, that's deeply disingenuous.
Yeah, as opposed to just blaming an intern when things go wrong at a company. That's not disingenuous at all. So I guess the fourth question, or the third, or whatever, the next question is the thing that's being covered up actually immoral? And in the case of a sweatshop company, yes. In the case of a football player getting caught for weed, no. To Dusty and I, anyway.
No, well, exactly. And that's the...
I think maybe we should address that earlier, but yes.
And that's the moral equivalence that I struggle with, like the moral perspective, the lens that I was looking at it through was, you know, there are irreplaceable things that Teddy Bridgewater Inc. is going to be able to do that nobody else can do. Nike shipping its t-shirt operations to, you know, Bangladesh or Brazil or wherever it's cheapest is an entirely replaceable operation that will have, you know, negligible cost for the corporation at large. If they were to change their practices and make their t-shirts more expensive, they might see a, you know, small drop in net sales, but the Nike brand will survive.
Right.
If Teddy Bridgewater Inc. goes to jail because he was going 40 into 25 and had 2 grams of weed in his car. That is an irreplaceable loss.
Yes, for the stakeholders of Teddy Bridgewater Incorporated.
Which are not just his posse or, you know, the team that he's on, or, you know, the people that are taking money from Teddy Bridgewater Incorporated. It's the fans of the team that he plays for.
Right.
It's his teammates. It's all of his future potential teammates. The rock in the water that is, the ripples that it creates are much larger, I think, or have more unintended consequences than, you know, some easier examples of moral outrage that can be associated with Fall Guys.
Sure. But then there's two more questions, which is, how important is the truth to fans, and would they continue to be fans if they found Teddy Bridgewater doing an illegal or immoral thing, knowing that those two things are different? If you have a Fall Guy for when you beat up your girlfriend, that is just bad. Right?
Man.
Dusty?
We're about to spend we're actually going to, later in this podcast, talk about how great Camel Party Adrian Peterson is. So, I mean, maybe there's something to be said for cognitive dissonance. I know that's a really bad answer, and it makes me look like an amoral actor.
Well, no, because we talked about this with Adrian Peterson before, about how people who were upset with him are now not upset with him, and I don't have a problem, and you don't have a problem with this, because that's how humans are. And people are like, many people are not upset with Lawrence Taylor, even though he raped an underage girl. And many people are not upset with a number of players in the past whose, you know, stuff was covered up but is now sort of trickling out. But now we're not fans of those people. Michael Vick, that thing with the Steelers.
Okay, I will say that it would have been absolutely deplorable, and I don't know if I could have gotten around it if Adrian Peterson had somehow clumsily tried to claim that someone else did that.
Right, but that's what I'm saying.
But that would never have happened. That would never have flown for a lot of reasons.
Yeah, but if it wasn't clumsy, would you have been like, yeah, no, it's if you knew that Adrian Peterson beat his kid, right?
But, and then he lied about it.
And then successfully lied about it, but you knew that he was lying, but like most people didn't know. That'd still be immoral, right?
This podcast would be a lot more preachy. I would have a lot more to say about that. But I mean, part of it, like, the Adrian Peterson thing is weird because he got to spend his entire, you know, NFL suspension in this bubble where he, you know, didn't believe he did anything wrong, and everyone around him was willing to support that belief. Like, he didn't have to have a Fall Guy because in his mind and the minds of the people around him, he never needed one in the first place.
Right, but I'm saying, well, I mean, that's just a different question, and the thing about Adrian Peterson is just, like, weird and uniquely interesting. But that is a different question than whether or not having a Fall Guy is immoral, and whether or not it having it leak out that the NFL endorsed a person who gave the advice to have a Fall Guy is bad.
Well, and if we could get Chris Carter for a Q&A,
You mean an honest Q&A?
I strongly suspect, yeah, an actually off-the-record Q&A. I strongly suspect that he would say, oh, yeah, I was not talking about trying to get a Fall Guy for, you know, punching your girlfriend and, you know, fleeing the scene or whatever.
Are you sure?
When you say it like that?
Well, because
I guess I'm less sure.
But there were rumors about this happening in San Francisco.
Oh, is this the Alden Smith thing?
I don't know. I'm not sure if it was Alden Smith or Ahmaud Brooks, who's just charged with I believe, sexual assault. But there were rumors about this happening. I think maybe it wasn't Colin Kaepernick, but it was around the time that, holy shit, the San Francisco team is awful. It was around that time.
I know.
Where,
so bad.
It was around the time where Colin Kaepernick was accused of sexually assaulting a woman, which, you know, it turned out to fizzle because he probably did not. But, you know, we found out that the 49ers had a liaison who was on with the cops, which by itself is not unusual, but then he was on their payroll, and his job was to clean up stuff for the 49ers. And so whenever a player got in trouble, they called him first.
Okay, but that exists around the league. The Ravens have a guy like that.
I know, but what I'm saying, I'm not saying that that's immoral, although it probably is. And I'm not saying that's unique. What I'm saying is I don't think it's unusual to have a fall guy or a system to avoid accountability for even some of the worst crimes, like domestic violence, because it was alleged that this person helped clean up incidents of domestic violence so that the 49ers and the 49ers personnel, like the players, would be clean of that. So that's
whatever happened to Aaron Hernandez's girlfriend. She went down too, right?
No. She testified against him.
Oh man, see that's a good argument against having a fall guy. If you ask him to do too much.
Yeah, but he cheated on her or something. She had all the reason in the world to testify against him.
I mean, aside from the part where she probably would have gone to prison forever, but
she had plausible deniability though.
Yeah, of course she didn't know what was in the bags.
I said plausible deniability, not like she obviously didn't know. Which is the same moral question, but I'm not making a moral judgment. I'm just saying she probably could have gotten off.
Man, this is a much more complicated question than... I should have known engaging you with it would have made it more complicated. But, I mean, I guess at the end of the day, I think our institutions have decided for us that Teddy Bridgewater Incorporated or Blank Incorporated and its welfare are more important than these messy questions of individual moral culpability. And
depending on how the moral culpability interacts with specific actions, like beating a woman or just smoking weed.
Well, even that is a moving target. I think it's pretty really easy to argue that being a fall guy for beating a woman was something you could do 2 years ago, but something you definitely should not do next year.
Well, I think in terms of your ability to escape accountability, yeah, there's no reason you should.
Well, why would you have a fall guy if that wasn't the reason?
Right. No, that's what I mean. But you're saying should as in a sense of practicality, and I'm saying should as in a sense of, you know, moral ought. Should as an ought, which I believe is a question you debated a lot.
No, that is fair, and I am debating from the side of a question that you debated much more, which is the more institutionally practical moral choice.
Yeah, and you're right that it is less practical next year to have a fall guy for domestic violence than it was 2-3 years ago. But I'm saying it's still immoral.
I mean, yeah, I personally in my life, look, Dusty O'Connell Incorporated is basically like bankrupt. What's left over from the donations to Norse Code after I pay for all the server space and the podcast hosting and stuff.
So bankrupt.
Dusty O'Connell Incorporated is not in danger of going under from some salacious revelations of what it did at the club at last weekend. Like that.
By the way, if any of the listeners hear that James has gotten in trouble, there's a 33% chance that James is not the one getting in trouble.
I would say more than 33.
No, because I think James is also the most likely to get in trouble.
Well, we give him the producer title. But, I mean, realistically, like, why do you think we keep him around? Not like...
Wait, so if we all had an equal likelihood of committing legal wrongs, then it's a 66% likelihood that if James were to mysteriously go under the legal charges, that it's because of him. But I think that he's just also like four times as likely, if I'm doing the math right, to do illegal stuff than the two of us combined. So, 33%.
That's a pretty good analysis, I think. In other Vikings news, Colin Loeffler had a job that was his to lose, and so he lost it.
The long snapper has been released. The long snapper battle is over. The long snapper battle has been won. Long live the long snapper.
Let us all breathe a sigh of relief. Blair Walsh was glad to know it so that he could focus on kicking during the Oakland game.
Well, so a couple of things to say about the Colin Loeffler release. First, I thought he would get released after I rewatched the game I should have tweeted something out so I could like claim firstness, because that's important. But yeah, I mean, in that game alone, he had issues with being on target. I remember one of the kicks, like a field goal or an extra point, is probably a field goal. Was way off target on the snap to Jeff Locke, the holder. And, you know, Jeff Locke did a fine job, you know, getting it down to the ground. And I believe, you know, Mike Prefer and Mike Zimmer, when they say that the kicks that were missed were entirely due to Blair Walsh. But I do think that Colin Loeffler actually did have a bad performance in the Oakland game. Probably should have said something about it before he was released, because it would have just been easier to claim the knowledge of it or whatever. But he did actually have a pretty poor game. I can't say he had a worse game than Kevin McDermott, because I didn't watch enough long snaps. Basically, I noticed that snap and another one that I thought were off target, and they were both from Colin Loeffler, but I didn't see any of Kevin McDermott's snaps, so I can't say that he was more on or off target, but I did notice that Loeffler had a pretty bad game, so that probably contributed in a lot of ways, especially because McDermott's younger, he's probably more coachable, but Loeffler was a really awesome dude. He's super funny. He's super nice. He's like a really chill dude. Specialists tend to be chill, but like Locke and Walsh are not that chill. They're very business minded. It's very boring.
It's business.
No.
It's no. Business time.
No. Although I have seen them in the locker room with only their socks on, but that's not related to what you were doing.
I was just singing a Flight of the Conchords song. I just like that song. I wasn't trying to make it sexy.
The song is sexy.
I know. I did put a little bit of Aaron Neville on it. It's business. It's business time.
In other news, in a pregame show, I believe with Fox Sports, because that's who he's employed by, Randy Moss said to Kurt Menefee that he might be thinking about returning to football. Dusty, your thoughts?
Meh. Fine.
I would love to see it, just for the Randy Mossness of it.
In other news, Will Smith wants to be in the next Men in Black movie.
I would watch that too, but with less joy.
Okay, but so here's my question to you. What are the chances that Zero. Randy Moss... Really?
Well, I can see the show notes.
Then where?
You said if he's going to play for Minnesota, he's not going to play for Minnesota.
Well, then where?
Any place that needs a receiver. San Francisco. That's one place. He was already there once, right? Seattle. They've got rings to chase and very few receivers, right?
I think you nailed it. I think it's Seattle.
I think it's... Well, it's
probably... Seattle or Dallas?
It's probably no one.
It's no one.
Dallas doesn't need a receiver.
That's true. Dez Bryant doesn't need another receiver on his team.
Yeah. And it's not like Terrence Williams is bad or anything. So, they're fine. Who knows? Kansas City
could use a receiver. Okay, but no, I brought this up because it's an interesting thought experiment, because Randy Moss Incorporated is very important to the person Randy Moss. And I suspect he would not
as a crew.
I suspect he would not go back to a team he has already played for, other than maybe the Vikings, if he thought that he could come back and, you know, relive some sort of the glory days. I mean, Randall Cunningham was quite old. Teddy Bridgewater is quite young.
Yeah. Yes, there's a lot of differences between.
But the Vikings are kind of an up-and-coming team. And, you know, admittedly, a receiver is not what we need to get us over the hump.
Right. Well, okay. So what? Let's first talk about.
Seattle strikes me as the obvious front runner.
Right. Okay. Denver doesn't need a receiver because they have Thomas and Sanders and probably someone else. There's other teams in the race. There's the Patriots. They never have receivers.
But Moss already played for the Patriots and hated it.
Did he hate it?
He must have hated it. He left.
No, he didn't. They traded him for a third-round pick. Do you remember the Vikings didn't have a third-round pick because they traded for him?
Oh, that's right. They hated him.
Yes.
Oh. Then probably not the Patriots.
He's still the smartest receiver that Belichick has ever played with. Including Scrapsters, Wes Welker, and Julian Edelman.
Oh, whatever.
So the Patriots are in the title race. Who else is in the title race? Not the Packers. Packers could use him.
No. Oh. Wow. Packers, excellent dark horse choice.
Oh.
Because he could come in and he would immediately be the hero.
That would hurt Aaron Rodgers would. Soul. Wait, I think I get it now.
This is our comeuppance.
I finally understand.
Wow. Okay, I know it's not a feature on the show anymore, but this is my wildly irresponsible prognostication for this season. Randy Moss plays for the Packers.
That's so annoying. Well, it's,
but,
do I do
but the, so, but the weird, like, speculative pieces are kind of all in place, though, right? Like,
obviously, I mean, with the Jordy Nelson injury and the fact that their backups suck.
The best quarterback in football finally surviving the playoffs? Wow.
Jesus. Well, okay, so for my wildly irresponsible prognostication, I kind of have to pick Seattle, right? Because I can't think of another team that's both in the race and needs a receiver, right? Because Seattle, Paul Richardson is basically dead. Ty Lockett's still a rookie. Jermaine Kearse is bad, I believe is what they call it.
He's not good.
He's not good. San Francisco's not in the race anymore, and he already played for them. Nope, not Arizona. They don't need a receiver. I mean, they could use a receiver, but they don't need one. The Steelers have enough receivers, probably.
The Steelers are stacked for receivers.
Probably.
They're fine.
Probably have enough receivers. The Browns are not in the race. They could use a receiver or four.
They need a quarterback first.
What?
Oh, wait, they have one. Brian Hoyer.
No, that's the Texans.
Oh, no, that's the Texans. No.
Yeah, sorry. Brian Hoyer is the only quarterback in, like, the last 16 years or something. Since, I already forgot his name. Since Derek Anderson to leave the Browns with a winning record, 10-7.
That's impressive.
Yeah. So but he's the starting quarterback for the Texans. Oh, they could use a receiver. They have DeAndre Hopkins, but Jalen Strong isn't impressing. They're kind of in the race. They would be if they had a good quarterback, but if you have a good enough receiving core, you kind of can force a bad quarterback to be average. So, I assert with, like, no evidence. So maybe, that's my wildly responsible prognostication. He plays with J.J. Watt and the Texans. Sounds like a terrible band.
J.J. Watt and the Texans is my Mumford & Sons cover band.
I was thinking of Josie and the Pussycats. J.J. and the... There's not enough syllables, damn it.
This is apropos of nothing, but do you ever feel like a plastic bag?
No. What? Why?
It just sounds so much more normal when Katy Perry sings it.
What's next on the show notes?
Something which there is actually not that much to talk about. The Norse Code Fantasy Football League. Whoa, and then I open the transactions page.
Are there other transactions besides me punking you all on Brandon McManus?
Yes. Michael Crabtree hit the waiver wire and then was picked up.
That's smart. Who does he play for now?
He was ditched by Can You Dig It?
And, I meant the real team.
You picked him up. Yeah, Oakland.
Oh, yeah. See, I told you that was smart.
Oh, we'll get an opportunity to talk about him at some point in the season, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's either going to be injured or playing, so yeah.
Oh, well, if nothing else, we can talk about him in the next 5 minutes when we get to the Oakland game recap.
Did he play?
Probably not.
Great.
Let's see. You, I think, are taking a big victory lap over picking up Brandon McManus over Matt Prater.
Yeah, Matt Prater plays for the Detroit Lions. Who knows how their offense is going to be? But Brandon McManus has been installed as the kicker for the Denver Broncos offense. So, hell yeah. My only worry is that because he's a new kicker, he may miss an extra point, which is going to tank me at some point. But you got to take the good with the bad. That's how you play this game.
That's a big risk in this league. I specifically, well, my kicker strategy is week to week, we'll say. But I'm starting with Atlanta's kicker because I want him to be kicking as few extra points as possible.
How did Chris Polk get cut after Hard Knocks? That doesn't make any sense. That should have boosted his value. Team TBA. Oh, who's TBA?
What? I don't know.
They suck.
Curious too. Ross.
Ross. Ah, I hate you, Ross.
I don't know who that is. I was really hoping that I could get like a usual suspect style reveal on my, and I know I will never be able to repeat a team name as great as this. It was like the year that I went as Justin Timberlake from the special Christmas box video, and I had a box around my waist with a picture of Dick Cheney in the box. Like, that was the best Halloween costume that I will ever have for the rest of my life. Nothing will ever be as good as that. And I was really hoping I could get a longer term reveal on my fantasy name, which is Balghazi Green Ellis.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm not sorry at all. What am I talking about?
Well, I got to say, James did put me over the top on that one. I initially was going to go with Benghazi Green Ellis.
But then, yeah, no, actually, no, James made the right decision for you.
I was like, but people might not get it. But then I was like, no, you know what? Politics, blah, 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 blah. Balghazi Green Ellis it is. I had to truncate it heavily for the 23-character limit, which, why is that a thing? In fact, I'm actually going to make a waiver wire move during the show right now. Who yep. is Can You Dig It?
I don't know.
John Judich? Ah, yes.
Gezanked.
Gezanked, you have made a poor choice. I remember cursing you for picking Kobe Fleener, like, two picks before I was about to pick him.
Yeah, but it's Kobe Fleener.
Hey, man. You went on last week and talked about upside.
Yeah.
Kobe Fleener's got that.
In what capacity?
He's a tight end on the Colts with a...
yeah, but there's another tight end on that roster that's better than him.
Well, yeah, but no one's going to put him on the waiver wire. And Andrew Luck's going to spread it around. It's going to be fine.
Yeah, he's got like five receivers to spread it around to.
And two tight ends, one of whom is Kobe Fleener.
Oh, my God. Go for hey, it. Man, no, good. That's a great move.
Hey, man, you should see his Kubiak.
I did not pick up the Kubiak. In fact, I paid for the Football Outsider subscription without Kubiak, so I'm clearly lost.
Not really. It was... Some of those were head scratchers. I was like as I was picking Bishop Sankey, I was like, really?
Isn't he gonna get vultured by Cobb? How many touchdowns did they project him getting?
Oh Lord, I'm not even close to having this spreadsheet. My computer situation is such a nightmare.
Hmm.
Well, that's the update for the Norse Code League this week. Not a whole lot going on other than transactions.
That makes sense.
I would like to report a much bigger transaction because I know that our fall guy took advantage of his position in the draft to draft both a running back and Russell Wilson the end of the first, beginning of the second round. And I'm going to either make him pay or pay him very handsomely for that decision.
Yeah, I guess we don't have a rule in this league about trades made against one's will or under coercion.
Against one's will? I assume it would be against the will of somebody not in the trade.
No. We don't have a rule about forcing people to accept bad trade offers.
Wow. James can go down sooner or he can go down later. That's up to him.
What are you proposing to him?
We're still working on that. I don't want to reveal details
next time of with Norse
negotiations
Code
negotiations publicly before they are finished privately. I don't want to tip my hand.
Wait, but we can't interact with the trade at all anyway. Whatever. Fine. Let's move on.
Well,
no one wants to hear about fantasy football anyway. Let's move on. It's the least traffic news in all of football.
DraftWho.com?
Sorry, that's FanDuel.
Oh yeah, FanDuel.com, our former sponsor. Did we ever get any money from them?
No.
Not even close to as much as we've gotten from you, our dedicated listeners. Thank you so much.
Yeah, we've made more money from donations than we have from advertisements.
And it is not even close. Like, other Vikings podcasts are starting to imitate our model now. Because they're coming around to the reality that I discovered last season. Hey, it's not begging. It's providing a quality product and then asking for fair compensation or perhaps sponsorship.
Sure. By the way, you should still donate to us.
Yeah, we'll get to that later.
Okay. Well, I'm just saying I don't want to overstate that we make significantly more money from donations than from advertisements, because we made all of $10 from all of our advertisements at all together anyway. So saying that we made more money with it doesn't say that we made a ton of money off of donations. Yeah.
Advertising on podcasts is really not a good hustle. Like, you hear a lot of ads on podcasts, and those poor podcasters are really not getting, like...
Well, unless they're like Ross Tucker.
Yeah, or if they're Leo Laporte, then they can, you know, yeah.
Then they could build, like, models and spreadsheets on how much freaking money they make.
So, that's true. They have to actually hire people to process all the money they make.
That would be such an amazing feeling. I can't keep track of all my money. You there. You take a certain portion of it to keep track of it for me.
Hey, man, I'm thinking about getting an intern for next season. Wouldn't that be great?
What would an intern do?
Intern stuff. We'll figure it out.
Like, get us coffee?
Yeah.
That sounds pretty good. Well, but if you get an intern, they're just getting you coffee, because they can't give us coffee, both of us coffee. You're in Denver.
I said I was looking into it. I haven't figured out the logistics yet.
Wait, well, how about...
I would want him to be an intern for all of us.
What, so they could mail coffee to us?
Amazon same-day delivery?
Oh. Yes, it's a very expensive thing we can make an intern pay for. That's true.
Or maybe they could just place a mobile order for you at your nearby Starbucks. So all you had to do was just walk in, skip the line, and get your coffee.
Is that possible, but with Caribou?
Who cares? Oh, I guess location. All right. Really?
Yeah.
There's a coffee place closer to you than Starbucks? Wow.
Yeah, there's 3 Caribous closer to me than Starbucks.
Does Starbucks know about this? Obviously not.
No, actually, there's 2 now. Damn it, they just opened one up in Nickytown. So, now it's only 2. Oh, good move.
They are taking over the world, slowly. Slowly but surely.
Okay, back to football. There was a football thing that happened over the weekend involving...
It was hard to watch, quite literally, due to the weather delay.
Yes, that was awful. I was able to get some writing done, though, so that was nice.
That's true. CeCe Norseman fell asleep before the end of the game and was unable to finish his Daily Norseman recap.
That is totally understandable. I get it. I get you, CeCe Norseman.
The game was fine.
That's probably the best way to describe it. yeah, the good thing is that the rain delay did not delay any starters from playing. Only backups, I think, right? No.
No, Derek Carr and Teddy Bridgewater both started.
Yeah, but Teddy didn't start after the rain delay. That was Sean Hill.
Oh, yeah. Correct.
But I think the starting offensive line was still in. So, actually, bad news. We had to go through the rain delay to watch the offensive line. B, a surprising offensive line. So, in Teddy Staying Alive news, the offensive line largely looked pretty good. Mike Harris continues to look like what you totally didn't expect him to look like, which is good. Not even just average, but good. I think Matt Khalil has been average. Pro Football Focus tweeted out a stat that said he's given up 0 pressures this preseason. Some of that is kind of an accident. There was a snap or two from Khalil Mack that Brandon Fusco saved him from. That was one snap, and another one that I would have called pressure, but you know they didn't, and that's fine. But that's all just nitpicking the overall larger point, which is that Matt Khalil doesn't look bad. He's made some mistakes in run blocking, but not many, and in fact, I would argue that he looks better as a run blocker than as a pass protector right now, which is not something you would have ever expected at any point in his career, even the ones where he was a terrible pass protector. So that's really nice. Joe Berger is not John Sullivan. He had a lot of blown blocks, so hopefully the back spasms are not a big deal. Brandon Fusco looks great. Mike Harris, like I already said, looks very good. TJ Clemmings, I'm getting a lot of blowback on. I don't think he looks good at all. I mentioned that he looked terrible in the preseason overall. I wouldn't say he was necessarily terrible in the Oakland game, but I think he was below average. He got a positive Pro Football Focus grade. That's fine, too. That makes sense to me, too, because the results of his play weren't bad. I just think that the way he played was bad, if that makes any sense.
Well, you mentioned last week after the Tampa Bay game that he kind of has a talent for getting his hands inside and, you know, preventing second moves.
Yes, he's very good at preventing counters and spin moves, yeah.
It seemed like, you know, maybe he wasn't quite. I mean, it's so hard to know because it's a preseason game and he's a rookie and whatever, but, like, I was specifically looking for that in game film from the Oakland game, and I was like, what?
Yeah, there's one issue with evaluating him. He only had 13 pass blocking snaps that were not helped by a chip from the running back or the tight end. And so when you nail it down to that, it's actually not super impressive, because I thought he made 3 mistakes in pass protection. I got into a big argument with someone who thought he only made 2. We got into a big argument about that mistake. That mistake is one that I actually feel very strongly about being hidden by Teddy Bridgewater's very good play against pressure. And that was a 7-step drop back. He dropped back to 7.5 to 8 yards behind the line of scrimmage. And then he stepped up to 3 to 4 yards ahead of the line of scrimmage before he threw the ball. And he stepped up because the pocket ahead of him was clean and because there was edge pressure coming. That edge pressure was particularly bad coming from TJ Clemmings when I believe it was Benson Mayowa snuck. He did the exact thing that we're all worried about, which is that he sped past him and snuck underneath his arms. And he got entirely free. And he got to the mark. He got to the 7.5 yard mark without any possibility of being pulled back. He wasn't controlled. He wasn't even being pushed by Clemmings. Clemmings had to let go of him, otherwise he would have gotten called for holding. And he got to the 7-yard mark, 7 yards from the line of scrimmage, completely free and ready to hit somebody, namely the quarterback. But Teddy had stepped up in the pocket. And people are arguing, or this one person, but I assume some other people agree, that is not an instance of pressure because the defensive end was not near him. To which I say 2 things. One, TJ Clemmings was very clearly trying to prevent him from getting to the 7-yard mark because he was almost willing to commit a hold penalty, and he was trying to overset the guy, trying to get him to move past him. Matt Khalil was also very clear on preferring the defensive end moving inside and controlling him across the inside of the pocket, which would have run across the 4-yard line instead of the 7-yard line, because he was pushing Khalil Mack on the inside. And the only reason that didn't happen is actually because Brandon Fusco blocked his guy into Khalil Mack. So that's another reason that's clearly not the case. But if Lumpkin or the nose tackle, who I forget his name, had rushed the A gap instead of the B gap, Teddy would not have had anywhere to step up to, which is not something Clemmings or Khalil knew when they were getting into the pass set. They didn't know whether or not the defensive tackles would rush the B gaps or the A gaps, but if they did rush the A gap, Teddy would not have had a place to step up, and he would have been hit by the time he got rid of the ball, which, you know, took 2 hitch steps. Their argument was that he took 2 hitch steps, and that's normal for a quarterback, which is true, but they don't take hitch steps that move them up to, like, the 4-yard line of scrimmage. In fact, a lot of books that describe hitch step timing indicate that you move back 0.5 yard, but most hitch steps in the NFL are up by 1 yard, not by 4. So all of those things are instances where are evidence to me that Clemmings gave up a pressure in an instance where, in a normal situation, Teddy would have been hit or sacked. But whatever. Pro Football Focus didn't count it because they shouldn't, because of the way the grading system works, and that's fine. But Clemmings did make a mistake. He just didn't block a guy he was supposed to block. The guy got a free shot. He hit the quarterback. And that was his assignment. He didn't do it. There was another instance that was pressure. Anyway, 3 mistakes and 13 pass blocking snaps is awful. It's the worst. It would be the worst pass blocking, mistake to whatever ratio in the NFL last year. And I thought that he had very troubling play, and he had some problems in the run game. He didn't finish his blocks. Some of those blocks, the person he did not finish, ended up making, the tackle in the run game. A lot of problems with Clemmings, and I'm worried. And I don't think that I'm just being a pessimistic fan or whatever by saying that, because if I really wanted to be just a pessimist, I would talk about how I don't believe in Matt Khalil because he hasn't played a bunch of good snaps against a bunch of good pass rushers or whatever. I don't really care. I think his technique is good, and I think he's got good balance. I would probably say some stuff about Mike Harris, but I think he's just been playing well. There's a lot of things I could just say if I was just a pessimist trying to stir alarm bells. But no, I just am worried about TJ Clemmings and his ability to protect Teddy Bridgewater.
Well, how about this? TJ Clemmings was a steal in the draft.
He got
a great value for him.
Correct.
But now that Phil Loadholt is injured and we have to rely on him to be a starter, that kind of sucks.
Yeah, and I still think the TJ Clemmings pick is a good pick. I think he's got a lot of potential, and I think he can be an astounding player, but he's raw. And
week one, no.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
No. No.
No.
I have no money. So Audie Cole, fan favorite or most hated person on the Vikings, depending on who you talk to, taking reps with the third team.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter.
So he's not the canary in the coal mine?
Oh, my God. I hate you. That's it.
Okay.
No,
he is not. Gerald Hodges will be starting at middle linebacker next week.
Yeah, and the Vikings basically signaled.
Cole's still going to make the 53-man. Yeah,
they basically signaled that this is what was going to happen, that everybody competing for the middle linebacker position, which is Gerald Hodges, Eric Kendricks, and Audie Cole, they're going to get a chance to start. Eric Kendricks started last week. Audie Cole started the week before. Now Gerald Hodges starts. That's just how it is. It's not an indication of their standing on the team. They just want to get them some reps of the ones in order to evaluate them better. So that's all it is.
And it seems like there's going to be a lot of kind of shifting between positions and packages during the season anyway. So, frankly, I just wanted to mention it so I can make that pun, which actually I wrote a different pun in the show notes so that I could punk a reef twice.
You just wrote the same sentence, but you realized that the pun was better served by moving it. That's all. You didn't. You just... made a better decision. That's all you did.
Just don't know what puns are. Blair Walsh, though. Pretty good kicking, right?
That was sad, and now I'm worried.
Right? Okay, but supposedly it was really windy. Comments on Reddit indicate that it was, like, super windy there.
Yeah, but it's going to be wind. Like, okay. Like, he's going to have some wind.
Playing the rest of this entire season?
Outdoor yes. stadium, and also against the Packers and against the Bears.
The only good thing to result, well, thankfully it was the preseason and, you know, who cares? We still won, but there's gotta be like a cottage industry of Mike Zimmer reaction gifs.
I would think so, but the camera's not on him enough. It should be on him. There should be like a picture in picture in the corner.
Zim cam of cold, hard stares at failure.
Exactly.
Oh. So there's a pretty cool article on Daily Norseman about, or not about, it's just breaking down the snap counts or how many snaps individual players saw in the Raiders game. I wanted to ask you specifically, what does this even like really make a difference other than just sort of like setting up what will eventually be the 53-man? Like, is there any reason that we as fans should be paying attention to this other than just to give context kind of to what we already know?
Snap counts don't give us much indication of things in the preseason. The order in which the snaps occur give us much more indication about where players stand among coaches, unless there is specific context for those players, in this case, Gerald Hodges, Eric Kendricks, Audie Cole. So, for example, someone was talking about DeJuan Harris's chances of making the roster. He doesn't have a chance. He has no chance. And you can tell that not because of his performance in the preseason, which has been very up and down. I mean, his yards per carry is very high, but he's blown a lot of pass protection assignments. I think he's dropped the ball a couple of times, literally in the pass game, and he may have led to an interception. That's off the top of my head. I haven't really looked it up, but that's what I think happened. But regardless, you know he's not going to make the team because his snaps have been behind Joe Banyard and Dominique Williams. And in the Oakland game, he was ahead of Joe Banyard, but I think in practices after the Oakland game, he was behind him again. And so he's taking reps behind. And so that's an example, and that example comes from an argument I had in the comments. of the roster prediction. That's an example of where a person stands on the rosters, where and when they take those snaps. But the snap count itself is not that important because it turns out Dwan Harris has taken more snaps than Banyard and Williams, but that doesn't matter because he's behind them.
An excellent answer.
Excellent.
Any final takeaways that you had from the Oakland game? I don't know. It seemed fine. Derek Carr was good.
Yeah, Derek Carr was good.
Oakland's offense will probably be more interesting to watch this season than it has been in seasons past. But, you know, the season
is still a long way away. Which is weird to say about a Bill Musgrave offense. But I like Amari Cooper, obviously, and he did a pretty good job. Except, you know, staying in bounds, even though that counted. Didn't really feel like it stayed in bounds. But I'm not going to, like, bitch about a preseason call. It doesn't really matter. But I will say,
It was pretty controversial. Reddit had a lot of things to say about it, but then again, Reddit often does.
Yeah, but I mean, let it go. But I mean, when it happens in the regular season, I will not stop.
I'll be less inclined to let it go then.
Right. Like the 5 timeouts they gave the I'm still pissed about that. 5 timeouts they gave the 49ers. That makes no sense. I remember complaining about it in the stands and the people around me being like, well, that can't possibly be true. And I was like, you just count them. Count them. It happened. 5. But, and that was right. But, I thought the defense looked good despite the fact that Derek Carr also looked good. And that Latavius Murray looked good. But you kind of want to see more from Brian Robinson, who had at least one major mess up. Chad Greenway wasn't bad, but he wasn't good. And there was an instance where I wanted him to abandon his assignment in order to make a play and be more creative, which is something that really, really good linebackers can do. But in this case, Chad stayed in his assignment. It's really hard to fault him for that, but I did anyway. I thought Anthony Barr wasn't as good as you'd hoped him to be, but he wasn't bad. Eric Kendricks wasn't as good, but he wasn't bad. Linval Joseph was amazing. He played really, really well. Tre Floyd was kind of silent. I thought Everson Griffin was silent against the pass, but he was really good in terms of run discipline. Xavier Rhodes played really, really well. Terrence Newman, aside from the Amari Cooper thing, I thought played mostly well. Trey Waynes had a really good pass deflection, but I thought he made a bunch of other mistakes. He, by the way, took some first-team reps in practice the day of this recording, earlier in the day, instead of Terrence Newman. So that's just interesting to note. And we didn't get to see a bunch of Harrison Smith, but I thought he played really well. And Robert Blanton, whatever. But a lot of that analysis tends to dovetail with my evaluations of players anyway, so I think if you're skeptical of it, that makes a lot of sense because I basically just told you what I feel about players in general with some changes like Everson Griffin.
Yeah, a couple of guys had some pretty cool stuff happen. Chase Ford touchdown was nice.
That was really cool, but he had an up and down game. Jesus.
Yeah, it was the best thing he did. He also did some, you know, kind of bad stuff. You know, whatever. I think this game, I mean, like I said, it was fine. I think it confirmed a lot of our suspicions about who on the team is good and first team worthy and showed off some of our players, you know, skills. But I mean, on the one hand, we didn't see the first team. On the second hand, weather delay, you know, whatever, takes people out of their game. Happens all the time in baseball. I imagine it happens in football, even though I'm sure they're like, you know, doing squat thrusts and running in place the whole time or whatever.
The whole time they're just running in place.
And doing squat thrusts.
That sounds so exhausting.
Yeah, it is. Squat thrusts are ridiculous. Well, and the third thing, Mike Zimmer, after the game, in anticipation of the game this week against the Cowboys, was like, yeah, we don't really, like, plan for preseason games, really. We don't, like, study or anything. We just kind of go out there and try to do what we do. And so it sort of makes sense to me that we would just see players, you know, doing their good stuff and not doing their bad stuff, given that there is not particularly any desire for anyone to, you know, show off what our team is going to be doing during the season, and also not really, like, preparing to beat a preseason version of a team.
Right. I have no additional takes.
You sure? Nothing hot? No.
Nah.
We're specifically anti-hot take here at Norse Code.
You've said that 3 times, and I suspect it's part of our marketing strategy now.
I would like to think it's part of our education strategy.
That's also part of our marketing strategy, having an education strategy.
If our marketing strategy happens to dovetail with how well we educate our listeners, that is, I guess, maybe not a happy accident, but a happy thing nonetheless.
Yes, if we appeal to you, that's good.
And that is good.
He was good, and that was...
and that was very good. We play the Cowboys this week, or a version of the Cowboys. Adrian Peterson is, you know, becoming famous/infamous, depending on whether you're a hot take artist, for not playing in the preseason. The Cowboys taking that shit to a whole nother level.
They're so awesome for Twitter.
Please elaborate.
All the fights! I've learned so much about how good players are fighting because of the Cowboy fights that have been videotaped and have gone viral. For example, Dez Bryant is really bad at fighting.
He's more of a catcher than a giver.
Yes. But
can he take a punch? That's the real question.
I think he can. He did, right? He took a cross from Tyler Patman, and he is like 40 pounds and like, you know, like 4 inches on the guy.
It's true. I mean, it missed the button, but it didn't even really like stagger him that much. Like,
yeah. And then he took one from some random St. Louis Rams player. I forgot who it was. Seemed to walk out fine. Lost his earring, but seemed to walk out fine. So he can take a punch. He just can't really. He's got a strong jaw. Which he juts out all the time in fights.
Wait, so he literally leads with his chin?
Right. He's like, right here. Bad strategy. He can't really throw. I mean, if you count super wide haymakers, then yeah, he's got all of those. But he's not a great fighter. Tyler Patman clearly has been in a couple of fights and has clearly also been trained in fights. He was on the balls of his feet. He was balanced. That cross was really good. It was quick. And he got out of range.
I'm actually watching
really
the Dez Bryant Tyler Patman fight right now.
Right? Tell me I'm wrong.
When this ad finishes, I will. Please continue.
There's an ad?
Something about not on my phone.
The ad's going to be as long as the fight.
I know. It is actually a pretty important ad. It's an ad about not texting while you're driving, which you should never do. God. As a pedestrian, it drives me nuts.
Just listen to podcasts while you drive.
Exactly.
But don't get distracted by them.
Much safer.
Have you watched the fight yet? Yeah, we're just going to wait until you've watched the fight.
Oh, yeah, man. Tyler Patman has clearly been in fights before. Like, he, as soon as he realizes it's going down, he has his stance set up and everything.
Right?
Like, he knows exactly what he's doing.
Yeah, it's so cool and obvious. I love it. Because as soon as I heard about the fight, I knew about the disparities that Patman, you know, was facing. He clearly has a reach disadvantage. He clearly has a weight disadvantage. And that comes from his height disadvantage. All of those things are true.
He can duck so far back.
Yeah.
Like, Brian tried to sucker punch him, and he just fucking limboed that shit. Like,
no, it was great. And when I heard about it, I was like, Patman's done. And then I saw the video, and I was like, yeah, I know who I'm putting money on in this fight.
Right?
So that was cool.
Like, it takes talent to throw a Superman punch when you're going backwards.
It's great.
That's, man. That guy has...
I bet he's a better fighter than Ray Edwards. Yeah.
If he wants one.
Yeah, in the flyweight division.
Whatever, they'll make up a new weight class. They have another weight class every 2 weeks. They're trying to find someone that is as dynamic and interesting as Ronda Rousey is. No one is.
But they have one in Cyborg. There's just, they don't have a weight class for her because there's only one weight class.
Well, yeah, because and Ronda Rousey is still beating her twice, like, and will continue to beat her every time they fight. So
no, you're thinking about Misha Tate. Ronda Rousey's beaten Misha Tate twice.
Oh, okay.
She's never fought Cyborg.
What, really? Oh, well, that's going to happen eventually, and Ronda Rousey will win.
Yeah, it's definitely going to happen soon. So Cyborg has to test clean for a year because that's been a problem in the past. And they will probably eventually agree to a catch weight, but Rousey keeps on claiming that Cyborg has to drop down to her weight, which, whatever, fine.
Whatever.
But yeah. So
I hope she just gets tired of waiting and fights her like in a catchweight fight.
yeah, I think that they're just gonna end up fighting at a catchweight. But yeah, she's undergoing Olympic style testing, and over the course of a year, she's gonna be clean. And then Rousey can fight her, and it'll be fun to watch because that's the only person that people think has a chance against Rousey. Although I think the next fight is a boxing specialist, which is supposed to whatever Holly Holmes or something like that. She's like a boxing champion, but I guess people think that
doesn't matter. Rousey doesn't box,
right? So stylistically, she's interesting, but I guess people who know a lot about fighting say she has no chance, including the only fight writer that I read, Jack Slack, who is so fun to read.
Great name.
Yeah.
Pen name.
I guess there was a boxer in like the 1800s named Jack Slack, and he's done a lot of research on a bunch of martial arts and came across that name and was like, that is great. So he started writing about it. He was just like a fighting enthusiast, and he just started blogging, not to write about fighting, but because he was like, a lot of you are wrong, so here's what I'm saying. And he is now like, he's like Vice's official
and mediocre bloggers
writer,
start.
And he's great. Yeah, it is how mediocre bloggers start, but he's great.
Football.
Sorry, what?
Football. Which was ostensibly one day. Football!
Okay, so Cowboys, they've got a really good offensive line.
The Cowboys really stunk it up last
week. Most of their offensive line was not playing.
They got killed by San Francisco.
Most of their offensive line was not playing.
That's true. That's true. And San Francisco actually, like, I don't know if they planned for it, but they definitely saw it and took advantage of it by throwing blitz after blitz after blitz, and it worked.
Yeah, that was an interesting game to watch. But, like, the most interesting was that it had nothing to do with the Cowboys. It had to do with Jared Hayne, electric punt returner, pretty good at running the ball, too, from Rugby Union? They're very different, Rugby League and Rugby Union. And I learned about it today by watching a YouTube video. But, yeah.
Hashtag smarter every day.
Smarter every day. But, yeah, so Jared Hayne played some kind of rugby and is now in the NFL, and he's not bad at it, but he's probably not going to make the roster because the 49ers have like 8 million running backs, and also he's a rugby player. So yeah. That was it. I didn't really notice that much about Dallas that was interesting or relevant.
I found somebody who I will call Babe if I ever see them in person. It is Dallas Morning News writer Babe Loffenberg.
Oh.
Well, that's only because it's his name.
That's very respectful of you.
I hope it's a he. Wow.
That was not very respectful of you.
The implications of that otherwise, dude, it's Texas. Who even knows?
I'm just saying, like, you just assume.
Babe Loffenberg writes in the Dallas Morning News, San Francisco threw a ton of blitzes at the backup guys. That was as much blitzing as I've seen from a team. Blah, blah, blah. This is clear to me. The Cowboys do not have a third tackle with NFL ability. So much as they want to let Lael Collins develop at guard, he needs to move out and get extensive work at tackle, like maybe tomorrow.
Wait, why? He has to play guard. Isn't there left guard above him injured? He has to play guard. That doesn't make any sense. Damn it, Babe.
Babe is a fool. But seriously, though, Lael Collins?
Yeah, I mean, what a pickup, right? Yeah. Ronald Leary's undergoing an MRI in his back. But that was 8 days ago, so I don't know if that's still true.
Well, he must have already done it, and it was probably fine.
Oh, but he didn't. I shouldn't say anything about him not playing, because it doesn't really matter. Because you would hold him out, right? Even if he was fine. Let's see. CBS has nothing on it. Someone has to have an update on this guy. That was 8 days ago. It's just sore, I guess. What? There's nothing since the 18th.
Maybe it's bad.
There's no way he didn't already have his MRI, right?
Dude, 8 days? No, that's weird that there's no stories on it. Maybe it's bad.
Well, anyway, he's injured, so Lyle Collins has to play guard.
Well, what about, like, I mean, they've got Lawrence Gibson and Darian Weems, I guess, to play tackle instead.
Well, Lawrence Gibson's like a seventh round rookie, right?
He had a good Pro Football Focus grade.
That's good. I liked him a lot. I thought the Vikings might have been targeting him because he meets a lot of their metrics for what they want in a tackle. He's got really long arms. He played for Virginia Tech, North Carolina State, one of those two. He's a slightly light for a tackle, and he was kind of inconsistent. Regardless, I think he's probably going to end up being a better third tackle than Darian Weems.
I was literally about to say, like Darian Weems?
Yeah, like Darian Weems. So I think that's probably going to solve that problem. Lael Collins can continue to play guard and blow linebackers up.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like with tackles like Gibson and Weems, like why would whatever, whatever, babe
or babe,
if that is your name,
probably is.
So, given that we play the like garbage version of the Cowboys this week and the Titans next week, is Mike Zimmer ever going to lose a preseason game?
Never.
Oh, man, I meant to look this up before the show. What's the longest preseason win streak?
I don't know, man. Why would you ask? Why would I know that?
It's okay. I'm asking Google, too.
No, I just asked you so I could fill some time on the show while I asked the real person, Google.
Google's not a person.
Yet.
It doesn't even pretend to be a person. It doesn't ask. It doesn't make you tell it a person's name like Amazon Echo and stupid iPhone. Google is its name.
Did Google contribute to Eagles?
Wow, the Eagles have the top three spots.
Wait, someone kept track of this?
Never mind, that's just the Eagles. Wow. Okay. So from 1959 to 1963, the Packers won 23 preseason games in a row.
They had preseason games back then?
Yeah, these numbers are... God, there's no good post-merger. I guess the post-merger winners are the 49ers with 13 preseason wins in a row from 91 to 93.
Okay.
And the Ravens with 12 preseason wins in a row from 98 to 2000.
All right.
And all the others are pre-merger.
So we need two more seasons then, right?
Easy.
In the bag.
We got this. This is over.
So that's the next wildly irresponsible prognostication a year from now.
Let's not go crazy. It's a near miracle that we're entering our third season of this show.
That's rude.
Not really.
We're
a fine podcast, but so many fine podcasts fall by the wayside. It is only because we were able to attract such an awesome and dedicated listenership that are even willing to give us money to keep the show online.
This sounds like still here. A marketing ploy.
It wasn't until you made it.
It already sounded like, hey, we wouldn't, you know, good podcasts fall by the wayside, but we didn't because of listeners like you. PBS.
They wouldn't have listened were it not for the content.
Right. That's why I was saying this is a fine podcast. But I wasn't shilling. I was speaking 100%. I wasn't shilling
until you accused me of shilling.
No, I'm the maverick.
I haven't asked anyone for money yet. Okay, but so is Dallas going too far by like saving Jason Witten? Well, okay, they're not doing too far by saving Tony Romo. But like, let's make December happen in October.
I would be a little worried if I were them, but given how many fights and injuries they've had, I totally understand it.
the fights, though. I can't believe I don't have a line in the show notes about the fights.
Yeah.
Let's put some fight videos in the show notes. That'll be...
easy.
Ooh, Jesus. All right. That's enough of that. Score prediction.
What? No.
No?
I refuse.
Is that your official prediction?
Yes.
What? No? All right. I'm going to say 27-21 Vikings.
Okay. I am
basing that belief. We didn't do a whole ton of analysis because, I mean, like Zimmer said in the press conference leading up to this game, you know, we don't really plan for this. We're just going to go out there and do what we do. And my prediction is based on, you know, both teams showing up with their second string, plus or minus, and producing more on offense than they do on defense. And that's all I have to say about that.
Hooray.
So, mailbag?
Yeah. Do we have a mailbag besides James?
Amazingly, yes.
I love our listeners.
I know. Man, just the best. I'm actually really stoked for, there's the Bears game at TCF Bank Stadium is on my birthday. And the stars are aligning so that I'll be flying into Minneapolis on my way home for Christmas the day before. So we can have a little Norse Code party.
Yeah, no, that's I'm super excited for that. And I paid James back, so I know I can go.
That's a different game.
Oh. Huh.
You're going to be going to lots of games this year.
Oh, man. Awkward.
That's rough.
All right.
Ben Johnson at Vandalvike writes us, could the NFL use nanobubbles to ensure proper football inflation? No.
No, they're very small.
Can't see them.
Can't even see them.
Tommy Gunn at Tommy the Gun 13 writes us, is Teddy really only a little better than Geno Smith?
Fun fact, he's worse. No, he's a lot better, obviously. And that's Geno Smith pre-jaw surgery.
So I think we can all agree that he is a better leader than Geno Smith, because nobody's trying to punch him in the face. We could also make the argument that he is a better financial manager than Geno Smith, because he didn't have to borrow $600 from one of his linemen to get on an airplane.
Well, I mean, he didn't borrow it. The lineman offered to pay for his flight, and then he canceled, and the lineman asked for the money back.
Well, and that's so rude, because Smith paid him, but not fast enough.
No, I heard he didn't pay him.
No, he did.
I heard he was planning to. I don't know. It doesn't really matter. He got punched in the mouth.
This is why it's better to just put that shit on a credit card and sort it out later. At least, like, whatever. We can't even get the whole story. We've got our ear to the ground at the NFL, and we can't even get the whole story on whether or not Geno Smith paid his lineman back before getting punched in the face.
It was not his lineman. He was a defensive lineman. He was the opposing.
Okay. Well, on his team.
No, I mean, clearly not his team.
All right, luckily we have one real question. RacerK at RacerCraft writes us, top five concerns going into week one.
I probably should have looked at the show notes before just now. So, obviously, TJ Clemmings, number one. Five is going to be kind of hard. It's a good team. Two is Blair Walsh. That's pretty easy, I think.
Kicks in the wind, yeah.
Yeah, points are good. And that is good.
No fullback?
I guess fullback in general. Yeah, that's a worry. That's fine. So, whether or not if we keep a fullback, I'm worried about the fullback. If we don't keep a fullback, I am worried about how the offense has been designed and how they can adapt to not having a fullback. So that's three, fullback situation. Four, probably game management. Mike Zimmer was not very good at time management, timeout management in the season, and that can win or lose games. And so that's a worry I need as a fan. I demand better game management from Mike Zimmer. And then
number five has got to be just
Chad Greenway.
The Vikings.
Chad Greenway.
Don't forget to donate to the Lead the Way Foundation at chadgreenway.org.
No, you can't donate anymore. Right, no, you still can. It's just the contest is over. Go ahead. No. Donate.
You know what? Don't.
The contest is over. The results are meaningless. Chad Life Greenway is does on good.
If he does well in a given week, then... hook them up.
No, you
if
should.
Chad Greenway's it up, then whatever. Then it's on the kids.
You should. Then the kids will suffer. No, you should still donate to this thing because it's actually a really good thing and it's a very efficient charity. But I am still worried about him playing football for the Minnesota Vikings as a starter. So there's
our number one concern is, as always, the and this may, you know, label me as like a Kierkegaardian nihilist, but the unknowable entropy that goes along with every Viking season.
But that's like an overarching, I wouldn't put that on the top five list. I would be like in the category of.
Is that like how the Holy Bible is never on the New York Times bestseller list? It's just always there. It's like an always like overarching presence.
Well, I mean, but you can get them for free now, so you can't put them on a bestseller list by definition.
You can get Vikings Misery for free too.
Well, but